Filipino tennis star Alex Ayala and her Spanish teammate Marina Rivera advanced to the quarterfinals of the W100 Vitoria Gasitia's doubles tournament in Spain. This after the duo pulled off an upset victory against their second-seeded Indian opponents. Now, for more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. Philippine Olympian EJ Obiena is now the second-highest-ranked pole vaulter in the world. Diane Castillo joins us with that story. Hi, Diane.
Hi, Stanley. Yes, Filipino pole vaulter EJ Obiena has again achieved another milestone in his career by ranking number 2 in the World Athletics latest rankings, just behind world number 1 Armand Duplantis of Sweden. Obiena rose to number 2 after his gold medal performance at the Asian Championships in Thailand. This level has never been attained by any Filipino or Asian pole vaulter. Before this, EJ was already ranked number 3 in the world. In June, EJ also made history by jumping 6 meters, a height that only 28 pole vaulters in the world have achieved. Currently, Obiena is in Monaco, where he will compete in a Diamond League event. Also upcoming in his schedule is the World Championships in Hungary and the Asian Games in China in September. Obiena has also qualified for the Paris Olympics 2024. He first competed in his first Olympics at the Tokyo Games in 2021. So huge congratulations to EJ, who continues to work hard on his game in Europe. Mabuhay.
The low-pressure area we are monitoring is now off the waters of Eastern Samar. It's expected to intensify later today or tomorrow. Meantime, let's get more details from our resident meteorologist, Ariel Rojas. Ariel, so is it going to be rainy days ahead again?
Good afternoon, Stanley. For today, Thursday, most of the country will be sunny and warm. But later this afternoon, intense thunderstorms are expected over parts of Ilocos region, Benguet, Central Luzon, Batangas, Cavite, Bicol region, Mindoro, Palawan, most of Visayas, and Caraga. Meanwhile, the low-pressure area being monitored was last spotted 705 kilometers east of Borongan City, Eastern Samar. The Japan Meteorological Agency has upgraded this disturbance to a tropical depression, but Pagasa says it has not yet met the wind and cloud criteria. Development into a tropical depression may be possible later today or tomorrow, and it will be given the local name Egay. The system will track generally northwestward in the coming days. However, there remains no consensus on the forecast tracks from different weather agencies. Some show a landfall over northern Luzon Monday next week, and others over Ryukyu Islands in southern Japan by Wednesday. Forecast track and intensity may be clearer by weekend, so please keep monitoring for updates. And here in Metro Manila, thunderstorm is expected again this afternoon or early evening later. That's the latest on the weather. Back to you, Stan.
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Ariel Rojas. The U.S. and China vowing to work intensively to address the climate crisis. That's according to U.S. climate envoy John Kerry, as the two superpowers resume climate talks, which were suspended last year. Kerry said Washington and Beijing will iron out agreements in the run-up to the COP28 talks in Dubai at the end of the year.
This is not a one-off meeting. We are already pinpointing the time for our next meeting, and then even the next one after that, recognizing that we have only about 4 months before the COP, and we have to make up a certain amount of time for the period that this discussion has not been taking place. And the climate issue is not a bilateral issue in our judgment. President Biden believes, as I think most of the world does, that the climate crisis is a universal threat to humankind. And we all have a responsibility to deal with it as rapidly as we can. And we hope we will leave other issues to the side.
The meeting between the world's two biggest greenhouse emitters comes as parts of the globe endure extreme weather events, highlighting the need for urgent climate action. In the U.S., for instance, at least 9 inmates in Texas prisons have died after suffering from heart attacks due to extreme heat. Local media reported another 14 died during periods of extreme heat due to unknown causes. Across the southern United States, temperatures climbed to as high as 110 degrees Fahrenheit or over 43 degrees Celsius. In Italy, 23 cities are under red alert following another day of scorching temperatures. The mercury hit 46.7 degrees Celsius in Sardinia on Wednesday. That's the highest in Europe so far this year. The high temperature is fanning the massive wildfires in Greece, which have burned for a third day. Authorities warned temperatures could reach 44 degrees Celsius on Thursday, complicating wildfire containment efforts. And in Croatia, at least two people were killed in a storm that hit the capital, Zagreb. Torrential rains also triggering flooding and knocked down trees. Red storm warnings remain in place in Zagreb and Karlovac, with authorities advising against non-essential travel. At least two people died in a shooting at a construction site in Auckland, New Zealand, just hours ahead of the FIFA Women's World Cup kickoff. Multiple people were reported injured, including police officers. Police say the shooter is also dead. New Zealand's Prime Minister says there will be no changes to the national threat level in the country, adding authorities are on top of the situation.
Clearly, with the FIFA World Cup kicking off this evening, there are a lot of eyes on Auckland. The government spoken to FIFA organisers this morning, and the tournament will proceed as planned. I want to reiterate that there is no wider national security threat. This appears to be the actions of one individual. Aucklanders and those watching around the world can be assured that the police have neutralised the threat and that they are not seeking anybody else in relation to the incident. New Zealanders' safety and the safety of our visitors is our first priorities.
New Zealand has welcomed thousands of international players and tourists for the World Cup, which it is co-hosting with Australia. Among those seeing action in Auckland is the Philippine women's national football team.